Hi, Assalamu Alaikum. In this video, we will cover analog to digital conversion, modulation, and multiplexing. I am Dr. Dishan Kaleem from ECE Department, COE WA Campus. Let's move to the lecture contents. In this video, we will cover analog to digital conversion, SNR and bandwidth, introduction to modulation, and multiplexing. So these three topics will be covered in detail in this upcoming video. First of all, analog to digital conversion. The key thing in analog to digital conversion is the sampling theorem. We have to know that what is the sampling theorem. So it is the basis of conversion from analog signals to the digital signal. For example, we have a analog signal, this like this, right? Sine wave. And we need to convert this into a digital signal, right? Like this signal, right? This is digital signal. So the first step to convert into digital signal is the sampling. What does sampling mean? Let's move here. Sampling means that from this analog signal, we have to take samples first, right? In this way. For example, one sample, two sample, three sample, four samples, five, so on, right? So this is almost similar shape like sine wave, but we took some samples, like from here, from here, from there, from here, from here, so on. So there is a one condition at which frequency we can take the sample. We should take the sample. Otherwise, the signal would not be recovered at the receiver side. So that what sampling theorem tells us. The backbone that supports the interface is Shannon sampling theorem. And that sampling theorem is named as Shannon sampling theorem, which states that if the highest frequency in the signal spectrum is B, for example, this is our signal and the highest frequency is B, then the signal can be recovered from its samples. If you will do sampling, then the only the signal could be only recovered when the samples are taken at a rate not less than 2 B samples per second. So it means that for a signal with a frequency B hertz, we need to take the samples at the frequency of 2 B hertz, right? 2 B hertz. In this way, the signal at the receiver side would be recovered. Otherwise, the same signal would not be recovered. So this is what Shannon told. This is called the Shannon sampling theorem. In short, if we have a signal of a frequency B, then we should have a sampling frequency of 2 B. To accurately recover the signal at the receiver side. The other important step in the analog to digital conversion is the quantization. What does quantization mean? Here, let's discuss. Each sample is approximated or round up to the nearest quantized level. The information is thus digitized. The quantized signal is approximation of the original one. For example, look at this. We have a sampled value, right? First, we already did a sampling, so we have this sampled value, right? These are some samples, right? And for quantization, this y-axis, we will have some levels, right? This type of levels. These are some levels. We will discuss in detail how much this level will be and what will be the effect of these levels. So for example, you have this sample here. So for each level, there will be a center value, this one, right? This is the center of this level. This center, 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 right? So for this this sample, we have to round off to the nearest quantized level. For example, this is it lies in between these two levels, in this level, then we will, if its exact value is, for example, 4.2, for example, here is power 0.2, but the center point is, for example, 4.1, right? This is 4.4, you can easily say it's 4, right? So we will approximate around a 4.2 to 4 this way, right? To the center value. Similarly, if look at this one, if this is, for example, minus 2, because this is under the 0, and the original value of sample here is, for example, minus 1.8, sorry, I will rewrite. For example, original value is minus 1.8, so we will round up minus 1.8 to the value of minus 2. So this is, in this way, the quantization occurs. This, we have a separate chapter for this later on. However, this is an introduction, so I try to explain you briefly about the quantization. So each sample is approximated or round up to the nearest quantized level. The information is thus digitized. And the other thing is that we have a levels, for example, starting from 0 to 15, right? And for each level, for example, this is 14 and this is 13 and so on. So we will also, after rounding off, we will also map it to the other bits, like for example, 4 is equivalent to, for example, we have a 16 level, so it is 1 1 0, for example. So 4 is mapped to the digital value, right? 1 1 0. Similarly, minus 2 we can map it into the, for example, 1 0 1 0, for example, because from 0 to 16 we have levels this way. So that's why we called it the quantized signal is an approximation of the original one, and the information is thus digitized. This is due to this 1 1 1 0, we call it as a digitized information. The important thing to be noted here is that we can improve the accuracy of the quantized signal to any desired degree by increasing the number of levels. What does it mean that here we have a 16 levels, right? From 0 to 15, we have a total levels L equals to 16, right? So to improve the accuracy of the quantization, for example, we change it to 32 levels, right? Or we change it into 64 levels. So more the number of levels, the more the accurate signal would be. So we can improve the accuracy of the quantized signal to any desired degree by increasing the number of levels. So this what it means, I mentioned here, L is equal to 16, 32 and 64. So here an example, as I already mentioned in the previous slide, just to elaborate more about quantization. For example, we have a 16 levels, right? Rectangle pairs representing the L different values to form the signal. So L different values, here we have a 16 values. Here L is equal to 16, and we can use 16 different combinations to transmit the data. What does it mean? I will clearly show on the next slide. The another combination that we can use are 4 levels, like this A by 2, minus A by 2, so on, to represent the data. So for example, you have a A by 2, minus A by 2, we have one value. So A by 2 will represent positive this one, minus A by 2 this one, right? And this 3A by 2 and this is minus 3A by 2. So 5A by 2, this is here minus 5A by 2. 15A by 2, here minus 15A by 2. So this is approximately 16 symbols, 16 levels, because there is a gap A by 2, 3A by 2. So 1, 3, 5, 7 up to this, so on. So we will discuss on the next slide, what does it mean by you can use the 4 levels like A by 2 minus A by 2 to represent the data. I already explained this quantization detail on the previous slide. So we will round off this to the nearest quantized levels, and then midpoint, and then we will map that midpoint to the bits, right? So other term that used is the pulse code modulation, PCM, right? Pulse code modulation, PCM. What is pulse code modulation? The process of digitizing and then using the pulse codes to transmit the digitized data is known as the PCM. As in the previous slide, I digitized, for example, 0, 0, 0, 0. This is digitized. And then convert into the pulse. For example, something like this one. Oh, sorry, not this. Something like this. 0, 0, 0, and 0. Right? So, to convert into something pulse like into pulse, we called it as a pulse code modulation. Okay, let's see that in detail. Example of binary pulse code. Now let's see that if we have a 16 levels, we have a 16 different combination. These are 16 different combinations. You will be aware of this, how to generate the 16 combinations. Then let's represent, for example, 0 is 000. So as I mentioned, 0000. So four different levels, right? Because there are four zeros, so there are four pulses of zero. So 0001. So three zeros and one, right? 0010. 0010. 0011. So 0011. So on up to 111. So 1111. So in this way, we have a four different combinations. By using that four different combination, we can transmit that information, sampled or quantized information, to the receiver side. And finally, we will recover to regenerate our analog signal. So, let's move to the SNR and bandwidth of a communication system. These are two very much important terms, because there are the two primary resources in communication. It should be remembered that the two things are very much important in communication system, and that two resources are also limited. For example, transmitted power and the channel bandwidth. So transmitted power is usually limited, or we can't increase the power from a upper value. So there is limitation in transmitted power as well as in channel bandwidth, but because the channel bandwidth is very expensive in the commercial market, and every operator has to purchase that bandwidth, otherwise they can't use, because these are the license bands. In certain scenario, one resource may be more important than the other. There are two important resources, as mentioned, power and the bandwidth. But in certain scenario, for example, in space communication, there is a power limitation. You can't have a power source in the space, so you must efficiently utilize that power so that there should be a long life of the space communication. The other is the bandwidth limitation, for example, in telephone, because there are number of subscribers, users, so we have a limited bandwidth, and we have to, or the operator have to, use that efficiently to use that efficiently, because to allocate that resources among the users. If they will not use that efficiently, then more users can't be accommodated. So objective of communication system design, the message is delivered both efficiently and reliably. As you know that everyone, including myself and you, will prefer that your delivered message should reach well on time, and should be correct as well. There should be no error, subject to certain design constraints like power, bandwidth, and cost. And the other thing is that we should take care of the power, because power is limited, bandwidth is limited, and the cost, because no one would like to purchase the more expensive system. So efficiency is usually measured by the amount of messages sent in a unit power, unit time, or unit bandwidth. So if per unit time, per unit power, per unit bandwidth is called the efficiency. Whereas reliability is expressed in terms of SNR, or probability of error. So more higher is the SNR, more is the reliability, less is the probability of error, more is the reliability. Okay, let's see this curve. There is one famous Shannon capacity formula. We should have, I think you should have studied that before. The Shannon capacity formula for a channel with a bandwidth B, if you have a total bandwidth of B, then how much would be your capacity? Capacity means upper limit, right? The system's upper limit. So C is equals to B, the assigned or the allocated bandwidth, log 2, this is log 2, 1 plus SNR. So what is the received signal power or signal to noise ratio at the receiver side? So in this way, you can calculate the capacity. So in digital communication system, is it possible to operate at zero error rate when even though the channel is noisy? There is one question that can we operate the system where there is a no error even though the channel has some noise? Yes, there is a chance of this. Zero error rate is possible as long as the X-link signaling rate is less than the C, because C, as I mentioned, is used as a capacity. Capacity means the upper limit, and signaling rate or the rate means that which you are currently getting in the system. So for example, this is the curve rate equals to C. This blue line shows that your signaling rate or the user signaling rate is equal to capacity. So this is our upper limit, and R is less than C. So this is the practical system where R is less than C. R is greater than C, I think this is not achievable, is unattainable, because if you will go behind the capacity, then there will be error. So there is a basis of trade-off between SNR and bandwidth. So this is SNR and this is your spectral efficiency. So spectral efficiency means bandwidth, like the like bits per unit of hertz, like BPS per hertz, right? This is called efficiency, spectral efficiency. As I mentioned, per unit bandwidth, right? It's efficiency. So this is efficiency versus SNR curve. SNR in digital is represented by EB over NR. So this is SNR, right? So we can achieve from here, we can conclude that we can achieve the error-free transmission if our rate is less than or equal to C. But if we will go beyond the capacity, then we will have more errors. The other important thing, which is the key in this course, is the modulation, because this course will focus on the modulation and how to achieve different types of modulation. So let's discuss first what is modulation. The baseband signals, what is baseband signals? It means that I am now talking, my frequency is low. Usually their low frequency signals are called the baseband signals. When there is no change in the original signal, these are called baseband signals. So baseband signals cannot be transmitted directly due to constraints such as interference, because most of the signals generated are in the same frequency range. As you know that I speak, you speak, usually we have a same frequency range. So if it speak at the same time, then there will be an interference or noise. You can take an example of a radio. In radio, you know that there are number of stations. For example, 88 megahertz, 89, 90. So there are different transmissions going on at the same time, but there is a no noise, because if you want to listen to 88, then just tune to 88, right? And if you would like to listen to 89, then just tune to 89. In this way, there will be no interference. What is this? 88, 89, 90? These all are modulated signals, because we are transmitting the original baseband signal at 89.8 carrier frequency, 89 megahertz carrier frequency, and the 90 megahertz carrier frequency. So that what modulation does. So Carrier baseband signal can be transmitted by an analog carrier signal by modulating one or more of the carrier's three characteristics. So there are three major types of characteristics. When we modulate, then for example, if you have a data like this one, and this is your data that you would like to transmit, this is your data, and then you have a carrier signal, which is, for example, a high frequency signal. Because if they have high frequency, because this is not baseband, this is high frequency signals. So baseband signal can be transmitted by an analog carrier. So this is analog carrier signal by modulating one or more of the carrier's three characteristics. So this carrier has three characteristics. One is its amplitude, this one. The other is its frequency, this one. And the last one is its phase. For example, the starting is here, starting is here, starting is there. So this is three main characteristics. Let's look that mathematically. So basic sine wave, for example, the carrier V naught sine 2 pi ft plus phi. Everyone of you know this equation. So this is the carrier amplitude V naught, and this is the carrier frequency f, and this is the carrier phase. So there are three main things. So if we vary the amplitude of a carrier using that data signal, then this is called amplitude modulation. If we vary the frequency of a carrier signal using that data signal, then it is called the frequency modulation. If we vary the phase of a signal using that data signal, then this is called the phase modulation. So that what mentioned here as well. These are some representations. This is your message signal, and this is your analog modulated double sideband amplitude modulated signal. We will cover this in detail in the later chapters, that why this signal look like this one. But the key thing is that this is your modulated signal, like AM. This is was the message that you like to transmit, and this was your carrier. And after, sorry, a mistake. For example, because they have a constant amplitude, not varying amplitude of the carrier. So when there is a, in simple terms, there is a multiplication of these two, for example, then we will obtain this third one. So this is amplitude modulated signal. Here you can notice that the amplitude of a carrier, this is carrier signal, right? The inside one is changed up and down. So this is called amplitude modulation modulated signal. And here this is called FM. Here you can notice that this data multiplied by this carrier, so we have this FM modulated signal. Here you can notice that this has a high frequency here, and there we have a low frequency. High frequency again, low frequency. So if frequency of a carrier is changed, amplitude is constant. You can notice that this amplitude is constant value. If frequency is changed, this is called a frequency modulation. Let's discuss the topic multiplexing. So as I discussed just before you, this slide just a while ago, that when you are listening to the radio, for example, this is radio 1, radio 2, radio 3, right? These three are different radio stations. These are the baseband signal. If you can notice that, these all are in the same frequency range, usually, right? This one. These all have the same frequencies. But when you like to transmit, if you will transmit these three radios on the same frequency, same time, then there will be interference. As I mentioned, you can't differentiate between these three radio signals. So what we do, we multiplex the signals, right, in frequency. For example, this is frequency from 0 to 5 megahertz. For example, I am just taking an example. This is not accurate value. 7 to 12, for example, then 13 to or 14 to 19, for example, megahertz or something. So these three are transmitted on different frequencies band, but these are high frequencies. 0 to 5, then there is a gap, 7 to 12, and there is a gap, 14 to, for example, 19. So multiplexing, what it means, there are two types of multiplexing: frequency division multiplexing and time division. In frequency division, this is an example of a frequency division, right? This is an example of frequency division. In frequency division, the frequency of a one channel is divided among n users. So there are n users, and user 1, user 2, user 3. So we divided that frequency, for example, 0 to 11, 19, among three users, right? It allows multiple simultaneous transmission. So in this way, we can simultaneously transmit the data without any interference. bandwidth will be wasted if any user does not have anything to send. Other users can't take advantage of additional available bandwidth. The one of the drawback is that of the FDM system is that if for example we dedicate the 0 to 5 for the radio one, right? So if radio one there is no transmission going on, then what would happen? This 0 to 5 megahertz band is empty and there is no transmission going on. In this way, what will happen? There will be a wastage of the bandwidth. So to overcome this, the proposal of time division multiplexing popped up, right? That is such time division multiplexing. In time division multiplexing, there is a, for example, we just discussed three bands, right? These were three frequency bands, right? But here what we did, in FDM we assigned it to user 1, user 2 and user 3, right? But there was a no time allocation here. Just for the whole day we have a user 1, for complete day, complete time we have a user 2 and user 3, so on. However, if we assign this the same band, for example U1, of a band from 0 to 5 megahertz, and then divide it according to the time, for example from 9 to 10 a.m. user 1 will transmit in the 0 to 5 megahertz, then for example from 11 to 12 user 2 will transmit, right, user 2 on the same band, user 2, and then from 13 to 14 user 3 will transmit, 13, yeah, time, it means then 1 to 2 p.m. User 3 will. So the same band 0 to 5 is utilized by user 1, user 2 and user 3, but in different time. This is what called the time division multiplexing. In this way, we don't have a wastage of the band. So TDM is another example or the form of multiplexing based on sampling, which is a modulation technique. In TDM, samples of several analog message symbols, each one is sampled in turn, for example this one, are transmitted in a sequence, that is, samples occupy adjacent time slots. Look at this. These are the axes, there is a time. So M1, M2, M3, M4. As I mentioned that, 9 to 10, for example, 11 to 12, these are time slots, right? For user 2 or message 2, so on, right? So on. So this is the concept of the multiplexing. So that same concept will be used for the other band as well. User 1, user 2, user 3, user 4, so on, but with different time slots. So in this way, we can more efficiently use the existing bandwidth. The other important concept is the redundancy. What is redundancy? In simple terms, we add extra bits to the message bits. For example, this is your message bits and you add the extra bit here. The reason for addition of these bits are to detect the error during transmission and are to correct the error during the transmission in this way, right? So error detection uses the concept of redundancy, which means that adding extra bit for detecting errors at the destination. So what does this yellow term, the additional bits, does? These will help the original data bits. These are not data bits which we are transmitting. These are just a security bits, you can call it, right? Or redundant bits, which is called the error correcting bits, right? Are the error detection bits. So this yellow part will take care of rest of the part, which is called the data part. Network must be able to transfer data from one device to another with complete accuracy. So to maintain that accuracy, we need extra bits. Data can be corrupted during transmission. So for reliable communications, error must be detected and corrected. So error detections means to decide whether the received data is correct or not, without having a copy of the original message. So in this way, error detection help without transmission of any other duplicate copy, they help these extra bits, additional bits will help to reduce that errors. In practical example, I can give you that, for example, at your home or at your town or your village, you have a security guard, right? You are paying for that security guards because you need to take care of your houses or your family. So if the condition of the village or a town is well and good, that there is a no robbers or etc. here in the town, then you don't need to hire that security guards, right? Because that security guards are costing you money and so on. So similarly, in the communication system, if the channel is reliable, we don't need these extra bits. But you know that the wireless medium is not reliable. There are some problems of errors, because whenever the data is transmitted in the air, there is a problem. So to overcome that, we add extra bits like the yellow one to take care of these data bits. So these extra bits are additional bits, are not your data bits. These are the security bits. Thank you for listening. For question answer, there will be a separate online session.